Thanks for tuning in and welcome back to the channel. As you can see, I'm in beautiful sunny Idaho. Spring has sprung, the snow is melting, the birds are chirping, and it's family bike ride time. Woo woo! And we're dreaming about bikepacking adventures in the summertime. So today I'd like to introduce you to my beautiful Salsa Cutthroat. She's tortified, proven, and my go-to bike for long, epic bikepacking rides. She lies dormant for most of the winter time. And today I'm gonna put her through the metamorphosis and transform her back into bikepacking beast mode for the summertime. So I'm hoping you'll join me. Okay, first things first, a little bit of history. I decided to do the Tour Divide, emailed Matt Lee my letter of intent, got super fired up, ordered a brand new force-build Salsa Cutthroat, the purple and silver one, super Gucci, built it up to my spec exactly how I wanted it. And once that bike was dialed, I took it to the Stagecoach 400 for a shakedown race, dialed it in even more. Did the white rim in Moab, dialed it in some more. I got 200 miles into the Tour de los Padres before I got food poisoning. If you're gonna order a BLT, make sure there's no mayo, extra mustard. 6 weeks before the Tour Divide, I was at Sea Otter Classic when my bike got stolen off of my bike rack. It still hurts me to talk about it, but that brand new Salsa Cutthroat with hand-built wheels, fully dialed in my whole kit. I'm talking sleep kit, bags, electronics, clothing, repair, tools, you name it, everything was on the bike. And at first, you know, my head just dropped. This is just a test. Life on the Divide is gonna be hard. The quest was on to find a new bike. I got on my Salsa dealer network and all that stuff. They were sold through. Couldn't find any mediums of any build. Crickets. And then my buddy Bram gives me this text. He sends me a picture. His dad's shop, Cycle Quest in San Diego, had a medium cutthroat on the floor. Do you want it? That was his text. I was like, done. The girls saw this bike, loved the orange and red, and decided to name her Sunrise, AKA Sunny. She took me through the Tour Divide. Not one mechanical. I aired up my tires a couple times, changed a few brake pads, and that was it. So this video is gonna be just about the bike in its naked form. Maybe my build can help you think about what you might be wanting to do to yours. I'll have additional videos coming out with the bags, the kit, the clothing, all that kind of stuff. Physical preparations, mental preparation. Please subscribe to the channel if any of that stuff is interesting to you. All right, let's get at it. Sunny started her life as an Apex build, which is the lowest component spec, and that's fine. So right away, I stripped her down and started to build her with the components that I wanted. She's since got me about 6,000 miles. So including my custom carbon wheels and pedals, this bike naked weighs 20 pounds, 7 ounces. So when I was rebuilding Sunny to the spec that my stolen bike was, I decided to do pretty much everything the same. So I built a second pair of custom wheels, Knox Teocalli carbon rims, laced to I9 torch hub in the rear, and an SP dynamo hub in the front, double butted spokes, red alloy nipples with a couple gold nipples by the valve stem. The wheel set is bomber. Unfortunately, when I went to buy a new dynamo hub, they were completely sold through and I couldn't find one. In a crazy stroke of luck, I was talking to Shay at K-Lite, who was rebuilding a custom wiring harness, and he's like, wait, I've got an SP dynamo hub 15 by 100 right here. I use it to test wiring. It's brand new, basically. I just spin it a couple times to make sure wiring harnesses work. Do you want it? just great stroke of luck, right? So along with my custom wiring kit, a couple days later in the mail, I had an SP dynamo hub. I was able to rebuild this set of wheels, and I love it. So for a cassette, I use a SRAM XG1195, which is the XO1 11-speed cassette. Very light, very expensive, unfortunately, but a great cassette. And what I did is I took off the 42 tooth granny gear and replaced it with a Wolf Tooth 46 GCX. If you're not familiar with those, it's fantastic. You basically just pry off the 42, stick on a 46, and you get 4 more extra teeth of granny gear, which trust me, you want everything you can. I know most bikes now are 12 speeds or people are going with the, you know, wireless shifting and all that, but the 11 speed with a 34 tooth oval ring in the front and an 1146 in the back serves me perfect and I'm not switching it. Big. So my tire choice are Continental 2.2 Race Kings. I only had to fill up air a couple times on the Tour Divide, never lost sealant, never lost tubeless. So if it ain't broke, don't fix it. There's this debate, right, between oval rings and round rings. Do oval rings really do anything? Who knows? I personally feel that oval chain rings work. I feel that in your pedal stroke and your granny gear or really low gears, it's smoother and you keep your traction easier. I tried 32, I tried 36, and in the end, the 34 was my sweet spot. Anyway, absolute black 34 tooth oval chain ring, bee's knees. By the way, there's links to everything in the description below. So cranks, the stock cranks that came on Sunny were super heavy. Pulled those out and put in SRAM XX1 Eagle mountain bike cranks. Very light, carbon, stiff. I use a 170 mil crank arm versus a more traditional 175. The reason being, the shorter crank arm puts less stress on my knees. So that's something you may want to think about with your own build. Bottom brackets are just a source of weakness, especially for long distance bikepacking routes, especially with a carbon frame. They're gonna fail, they will fail. So do yourself a favor, get rid of it right away and pop in a Chris King bottom bracket. Best investment you'll make. Contact points are so important. Anywhere my hands touch, my feet, my butt, super important. It's worth taking the time to just get that as dialed as you can. No matter what, you're still gonna have issues. A lot of people will double wrap tape, or they'll put an inner tube and then tape on top of it. With bar tape, I only use DSP 2.5 millimeter from Lizard Skins. It's a cushy bar tape that's great in all weather. It stays grippy when it's wet. And underneath it, I use Physic Bar Gel. And between those two things, I think it's a great combination for bar tape. I have a pet peeve with end plugs. They're always popping off, the cheapy plastic ones. Your tape starts to unravel. No matter how well you do it or how pro of a bar tape wrapper you are, there's always drama with that. So I switched out to these super sweet Hope Alloy bar end caps. They screw on and tighten up with an Allen wrench. Totally not necessary, but it is Gucci. I think they're like 20 bucks or something. I don't know. Let's talk about the shifter and the brakes and the derailleur. All of them Force One, Force HRD hydraulic disc brakes. They have much more stopping power than mechanical brakes, which is great on steep high speed descents with a loaded bike. And this also minimizes hand fatigue over long hours in the saddle. Force One by rear derailleur, 11 speed. I know a lot of people that like wood chippers, cow chippers, this chipper, that chipper, I don't know. My handlebars are carbon. They're Easton EC70 AX 44 centimeters wide. So these are basically Easton's carbon gravel bars. They're a little wider with a little more flare. I tried a bunch, they're comfy for me. It's a very subjective thing, I like them. Saddles are super personal. I have narrow sit bones and the Pro Griffin in 132 width has served me well. Everybody's got preferences on pedals. I like Crank Brothers. Candy 7 pedals are reliable and shed mud and snow with ease, which is very important on the Divide. So another component I really dig is the seat post. I went with a P6 carbon flex post from Sintassi. It's carbon, but it still has a little bit of give, especially since it's only 27.2 thickness, which helps a lot for compliance. The headset came stock with the bike, one of the few stock pieces that are still on the bike. It's a Cane Creek 40. The 40 is a tiny bit heavier than the 100 or 110 series, but it's bulletproof and I didn't feel like messing with the headset and I've had no problems. I went with a Niner stem that I love that I happen to have sitting around, happens to be orange and match the bike, 90 mil carbon stem, the RDO. For a chain, I just kind of use whatever I've got around. An 1170 is what I prefer to use. It's kind of middle of the road. It's not that heavy, but it's very strong. It also happens to be the exact perfect amount of links for my bike, so when I need to put a new one on, I don't even have to cut the links. Boom, bonus. So you might have noticed I have a little extra length on the top of my steer to leave room for my fret bar and my dynamo power switch. Don't cut your fork, set it all up, make sure all your stuff fits first. Next thing you know, if you've already cut your fork, you're screwed. That was a mouthful. Thanks for hanging into the end. Hope this gave you some insight, maybe some inspiration for your own bikepacking build. So in my next video, I'm gonna be putting on the aero bars and the Fred bar and all the bikepacking bags and start gearing it up. So make sure you subscribe if you haven't already. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them down below. I'd love to hear from you. Thanks for watching. Catch you on the next one. Thanks so much for squeezing dirty teeth into your busy schedule. Please help us reach more people and ensure you receive new videos by giving this video a like, subscribing to the channel, and clicking the notification bell. Until next time, ride bikes, drink beer, live happy.